This skill is going to demonstrate bleeding control in order, and what we do for typical bleeding patients. So we just put a little red mark on Brian's arm here to show an area of injury. So first thing we're going to do is when we find an area of bleeding in our primary survey and we consider it to be life-threatening bleeding, so we find some blood on the shirt, expose the shirt, and there's an area of avulsed tissue or arterial spray. I have my gloved hand, I place my gloved hand over top of the wound immediately and put direct pressure on the wound to staunch the bleeding. And then I'm going to use a large enough dressing. Try to stay away from small 2x2s and 4x4s. You want something that's bulky and absorbent that can provide enough absorbance or enough tamponade of the blood flow. So I've got one or two of these. I can fold them over for effect. Place that on top of the wound. And then what I'm going to do is use Cling or Curlex, which is self-conforming bandage. And notice the way I'm holding the roll. I'm rolling it away from myself in a curl. I'm not pulling it out. So now I put the tail on top and I apply pressure. And I take the cling and wrap the dressing with the cling, which is considered to be the bandage. So at any point, I don't have to use the whole roll. At any point where I feel I've got enough pressure on, I'm then going to cut the cling. So what I do is take the scissors and cut down the center of the cling. And I tie a knot in it. So I take one strand one way, the other strand the other way, tie at the top. So now I've got the dressing tied up. Now, if it starts to bleed through and I don't get good control of the bleeding, I'm then going to take a second dressing to reinforce it. So I use another abdominal pad on top. I do not remove the first one. I take a second roll of cling over the remnant of the first and apply that dressing around again. Doing exactly the same thing, tying it off. If this was a typical dressing or typical bleeding that I was concerned about, I would always check CWCMS prior to putting the dressing on and CWCMS after my dressing on, so I don't make a tourniquet effect. If this was life-threatening bleeding, I want to make sure I'm not too concerned about CWCMS. I want to stop the flow of blood. So typical bleeding that we're dressing, always check CWCMS prior and post. If it's life-threatening bleeding, stop the bleeding first. So we've got two dressings on. We can put a third dressing on if required, if the bleeding's still not under control. And if that doesn't work, we can go to indirect pressure, knowing full well the brachial artery runs under the bicep and splits here and comes down. So we have the radial artery here and the ulnar artery here. So what I'm going to do then is apply pressure against indirect pressure against the brachial artery with the fat pads of my fingers in order to staunch the flow of blood to here. I could then raise the arm if there's no fractures. So rest elevation and direct pressure above the level of the heart to try and slow the bleeding down. If that doesn't work, direct pressure, three dressings, indirect pressure, I can then go to the use of a tourniquet, and according to the Manitoba ETGs, the tourniquet for the arm is to be applied as close to the wound as possible. If it's on the leg, you always apply the tourniquet above the knee or higher depending on where the injury is. So just to clarify again, if I have an injury on the forearm, doesn't matter where it is on the forearm, the tourniquet goes as close to the wound as possible. On the leg, it's in the lower leg, the tourniquet always goes above the knee. So we have to be aware of that. If I'm going to use a tourniquet, I can use any broad bandage or anything else, put a stick in, make a windlass, and tighten it up. But here's a way of making a tourniquet that works quite effective, and I'll use a BP cup. So naturally, according to ETGs, I would go as close to the wound as possible. Well, in this case, just for clarity and ease of application, I'm going to go above the elbow. Put the blood pressure cuff on. I can then pump the blood pressure cuff up until the pulse disappears. Once the pulse disappears, I can take another 30 up, just like I'm taking regular blood pressure, or keep it at the area of the systolic pressure where the pulse disappears. But the one thing you must do now is take a clamp, apply the clamp over top of the pump side on here, because this will naturally leak or bleed of air over time. So if I have this occluded, this tube on the pump side, that will maintain the air pressure at 130, 140, whatever the occlusion pressure was, and therefore we've got an adequate BP. The rule of thumb for BP application is to put the BP, if the transport is greater than 2 hours and it's required to place a tourniquet, at the end of 2 hours we can release the tourniquet for 3 to 5 minutes while applying direct pressure, So we would if this was a 2-hour transport and this tourniquet was in place, I'd release the pressure, hold on to the area and try and tamponade any further blood flow, let the arm reperfuse for 3 to 5 minutes, and then take the cuff back up to its original pressure. And then every half hour thereafter, we would reduce the pressure. So the 2-hour mark, let the air out, tamponade blood flow, 3 to 5 minutes, and every half hour thereafter we do that.